Good morning and welcome to the 12th meeting of the Citizen Participation and Public Petitions Committee of 2023 and our first meeting after the summer recess, which I hope all colleagues and have enjoyed, and I hope everybody's enjoyed the summer actually, notwithstanding the weather. Our first item is a declaration of interests, and as members will recall, our colleague Alexander Stewart has left the committee. We were able to thank him for all his work when he was last with us. Alexander, I gather, will be able to join us at the launch of our democracy inquiry, the public participation democracy inquiry next week. But we welcome in his stead our new colleague Maurice Golden and offer him the opportunity to refer to any interests.
Thank you, convener. I'd just like to declare I'm a fellow of the Royal Society for Arts, Manufactures and Commerce, which does some work on citizen participation, although I haven't been involved thus far.
Well, I think that's the most interesting declaration I've heard in a very long while. So thank you for that. And we move thereafter to item two, which is simply to invite colleagues to agree to take item five and item six. And item six in private. Are we content to do that? We are. And that brings us to the consideration of continuing petitions, the first of which is petition 1905, which is public inquiry into the response of religious organisations to allegations of child sex abuse since 1950, lodged by Angela Rosina Cousins on behalf of UK XJW support. And the petition calls on the Scottish Parliament to urge the Scottish Government to order a public inquiry into the actions taken by religious organisations in response to child sex abuse allegations since 1950. Now, since our last consideration of the petition, we've written to the Scottish Government highlighting the recommendations of the independent inquiry into child sexual abuse in England and Wales. And as part of that communication, we called again for the Scottish inquiry to have its terms of reference extended, or for the Scottish Government to investigate the possibility of establishing an alternative inquiry in order to meet the scope of the inquiries taking place elsewhere. However, we've since received a response from the then Deputy First Minister John Swinney restating the Scottish Government's position that widening the inquiry's remit is not practicable as it would make the inquiry unmanageable in scope. The response states that it is imperative, quote, that resources are dedicated to ongoing work to implement the national guidance for child protection. Do colleagues have any comments or thoughts in light of the Deputy First Minister's latest response? David Torrance.
Thank you, convener. I'm reluctant to close this petition down, even though the Scottish Government have said they will not widen it. So I think we should try again and write to the new Deputy First Minister to reiterate the committee's recommendations that the Scottish Government extends the Scottish Child Abuse Inquiry terms of reference to include religious organisations, or establish a separate public inquiry to address the issues highlighted in the petition, and to ask the Scottish Government what work has been undertaken since the submission in January to consider the recommendations made in the report on child protection in religious organisations and settings in England and Wales, and how the Scottish Government monitors the implementation of national guidance for child protection, what steps the Scottish Government is taking to ensure that religious organisations are aware of and adhering to guidance, and how the Scottish Government demonstrates its support and challenge function with religious organisation in relation to these issues.
Fergus Ewing.
Yes, I very much support what Mr Torrance has recommended. Could I just maybe supplement that and perhaps ask that when we do this, we draw specific attention to the useful material which the clerks have provided in their note in paragraph 9. And what I'm getting at here is that the independent inquiry into child sexual abuse in England and Wales published its final reports in October 22, and the note then refers to recommendations 2, 9, 13 and 19, all of which appear to have relevance. In Mr Swinney's reply, he said that the ongoing inquiry may well consider the issues that are of relevance here, but he didn't really go into any specifics, and these specifics have been drawn out by the clerk, at least four of them. There may be others as well. The point I'm making is that it would be useful, I think, just to give the DFM austere, that in particular, as well as the general points that Mr. Torrance has made, it'd be useful to hear whether the existing inquiry is going to specifically consider all the pertinent recommendations that have been made by the English inquiry. Because if we are to accept the government approach, then it could really only be on the basis that it is going to cover all the relevant issues, but albeit in a different way, and even if it perhaps is unsatisfactory because we haven't heard evidence, etc. But I just wanted to make that specific point.
That's fair. Are we content with that? I might just also ask that there's a bit of a flavour in here, which is we need to... obviously the government has made its argument, but the implication or the inference for people who are not covered by the scope of the inquiry is that the abuse they suffered is not worthy of an inquiry in its own right or further investigation. And I think that's an unfortunate conclusion. And it may well be that, as Fergus Ewan suggests, that they're going to touch on this matter in a different way. But I think it would be helpful if we could invite the government to spell out why that they feel that, because it means that I think we could actually say we as a committee are going to have to go back to the petitioner to say that, in essence, the issue that they have identified is not thought sufficiently serious by the government to warrant them investigating it in a formal way. And I think that isn't a conclusion with which the government should be comfortable. Are we content? Thank you all very much. That brings us to our second petition, and I gather we have the petitioner with us again this morning in the public gallery. Good morning. And that's petition number 1911, Review of the Human Tissue Scotland Act 2006 as it relates to postmortems, lodged by Anne Stark, and it calls on the Scottish Government to urge the Scottish Parliament to urge the Scottish Government to review the Human Tissue Scotland Act of 2006 and the relevant guidance to ensure that all postmortems can only be carried out with the permission of the next of kin, do not routinely remove brains, and offer tissues and samples to next of kin as a matter of course. And again, in our consideration of this petition, we're joined by our colleague Monica Lennon, NSP. Good morning to you as well, Monica. Members will recall our evidence session with the Lord Advocate and Andy Shanks, head of the Scottish Fatalities Investigation Unit, at the Crown Office and Procurator Fiscal Service, which we held just in June. Since that meeting, we have received further information from the Crown Office and Procurator Fiscal Service, and that written submission states that the COPFS is working with pathology providers on a service redesign. Its preference is to have a national pathology and mortuary service established under NHS leadership. Now, on the issue of CT scanning, the submission notes that representations have been made by two pathology providers on the viability of using scanning in post-mortem examinations. I think that's progress on the position we've understood it to be before. The petitioner, Anne Stark, has provided two written submissions. The first notes the upcoming service redesign and states that there is an opportunity to introduce the use of scanners in murder and suspicious cases, and emphasises the importance of taking grieving families' perspectives into account if a national service is to be established. And in her second submission, Anne Stark reiterates the importance of families having a choice about what happens with their loved ones and highlights the use of scanners in London to check for prostate cancer, which I think was a very recent news story. It was MRI, wasn't it, they were talking about for that. In addition to the two submissions that are included in the papers, we have all received numerous email communications directly from the petitioner raising issues relating to her petition. And I do want to say to the petitioner, if you forgive me, that while I fully understand her desire to ensure that we are fully informed, it is most helpful if these submissions can go to the clerks, because it causes confusion amongst the members if we get them, because we're then not sure what the actual operational process is in us dealing them. But I can assure you, if they go to the clerk, we do get them in a concise form, and that would certainly, I think, just assist us. Before I open us to wider comment, and also given that Monica Lennon was with us when we heard our evidence from the Lord Advocate and from Andy Shanks, I wondered if Monica was anything Monica would like to say.
Thank you, Convener. It's lovely to be back and to have the opportunity to be with the committee again, and it is good that we have Anne and Jerry Stark in the gallery today. It's the loss of their son Richard who's brought us all here and brought all this evidence and discussion into the Parliament arena, but also into the public. And Anne is a prolific email writer and sender, and not to make you feel that you're not special, but I think Anne has been writing to every MSP and has been getting a really warm response, and more people are coming forward to say the issues that we're looking at are really important. I won't repeat everything I said in summary at the last session in June. It was quite an intense session that we had with the Lord Advocate and Mr. Shanks. I think at points it was frustrating just to try and find out who is going to take responsibility for this. I think Mr. Ewing and Mr. Stewart in particular teased a lot of that out. But in the end, the Lord Advocate acknowledged that we all want a humane and progressive system. We do need to be robust and thorough in investigating deaths where there is suspicion, but it needs to be proportionate. And I think what the petitioner has highlighted in prompting this inquiry is that in Scotland, we're not keeping pace with modern practice elsewhere, not just in England. We've heard about the experience in Lancashire, but practice in Japan, Australia, and other examples. So we want to keep pace with that. What also gave me some comfort was that the evidence that we heard from the colleagues in Lancashire is that those innovations have been cost neutral to the public authorities. And I think that's important for us as parliamentarians to understand what could be the cost implications. But I thought that was really important. Of course, we all want families to be treated with respect and with dignity and compassion. And unfortunately, that's not always been the case. We've heard about some of the workforce challenges. No one wants to minimise those. But again, the proposals that have come forward to the committee would help with workforce pressures and future workforce planning. Again, I'm sitting here as a Central Scotland MSP. The family behind me are from Lanarkshire. You know, they rightly are wondering why families in Lancashire can benefit from this service and no one's really been looking at it in Scotland up until now. So, Convener, it is welcome that you've had an update from the Crown Office over the summer in terms of this service redesign. But again, going back to the title of the petition and the ask of the Scottish Government, you know, the Scottish Government have really been sitting back on the sidelines, in my view, while everyone else has been here trying to figure out what to do. So I think it's really important that government, you know, is aware that this is something that the Parliament has taken really seriously, that ministers are fully engaged, because looking back at the notes from the last session, the Lord Advocate pretty much said, you know, if I get a steer on what to do next, I will do it to the best of my ability, but that isn't really up to me. Well, we do need leadership on this issue. You know, again, it's a huge credit to Mrs. Stark, who's brought forward the petition, but it's been a huge personal cost to her. She spends every waking hour on this, and she doesn't get a lot of sleep, I can tell you. So it's really important that all of us do the right thing by her and other families. And I would be really interested to hear what government and other partners will do next, because up until now, no one's really picked the ball up on this. It's been left to families, which is unfair. But I really appreciate all the time and effort by this committee, because we started at a place where it was like a blank sheet of paper. No one really knew what was going on. And now, thanks to the committee, we've got a ton of evidence, not just in the UK, but what's happening internationally as well. I think that's really important. So from me, a big thank you to all of the committee.
Thank you very much, Monica. And I think you described the evidence session we had as tense, I think. And I think that's a fair description. Having read it, I think you characterise it correctly in many respects. Although it was a slightly tense atmosphere, the Lord Advocate was clearly sticking to the view of where her responsibilities lay. Where I think the committee got slightly frustrated was it wasn't really clear thereafter where she thought it was for the committee to go to get the correct answers. And that's, I think, where we have been reflecting, because I believe, given the evidence that we heard from the pathologists in Lancashire and the other evidence we've heard, that members of the committee are minded to seek to do everything we can to advance the aims of the petition. And I wonder, in the light of those remarks, if colleagues have got any contributions to make. Fergus Ewing?
Yes, I do agree with that, and it's very helpful to have Monica Lennon's exposition at the beginning here. Thank you, Monica. But I just wanted just to refer to a couple of bits of the evidence and then make a couple of recommendations. The Royal Advocate was really very, very clear that it wasn't really her role to deal with matters relating to pathology. She starts off on page 13 by saying that they don't have a role in relation to the recruitment or training of pathologists, and then on page 15 she says it's really for the professional body to consider the quality, efficacy and benefits of the imaging and to determine whether imaging should be utilised in the process being undertaken if the Royal College has identified a means by which postmortems can be less invasive. Then I, as the Lord Advocate, would reasonably expect the pathologist advising the Crown would explain that the process was available and should be used. So, in a sense, the Lord Advocate is saying, well, it's not my job, but if I'm advised by the experts in the pathology world that this is something that should happen, as it does apparently in England and we hear today in Japan and elsewhere, then that's something that she would pay heed to in her role, which seems to be no more than common sense and entirely logical and correct. Therefore, I do think that, with one caveat, Convener, I think we should take up the suggestion of writing to the Royal College of Pathologists to highlight the evidence session, to point out the evidence from the practitioners in England, to stress that scanning and other processes appear to be available in England but not here, to ask for an explanation about why that is, to get their views, perhaps orally if necessary, but in the first instance in writing, as to what their view as to these matters is, particularly whether, as the petitioner very clearly argues, that this is something that's a clear gap in the Scottish system, which results in the conclusion that the petitioner makes that nobody appears to care, which struck me in her remarks. The one caveat is that the petitioner herself pointed out, I think, that the contract the fiscal service has, the service contract which the Lord Advocate referred to a couple of times, expires in 7 months' time. And if that's the case, then the new service level contract, we may as a committee feel that that should include specific duties to enable this provision of scanning, etc., to be available where appropriate and to be specifically referred to in that service level contract. For that to happen, and working backwards from that, Convener, perhaps we might want to flag up to the Minister now that this is something that's in our minds to do, subject to getting professional expert advice from the pathologist. The last thing I would say is, and the clerks have flagged this up, that there is a suggestion that pathologists say that some of the medical clinical decisions may involve radiologists as well as or instead of pathologists. So perhaps the clerks could consider from whom we require to obtain the most relevant evidence here, and whether it's one or other or both. I suspect perhaps both.
Thank you very much. No, that's incredibly helpful. And I think it might be useful just to refer in the including the reference that Fergus Ewing has made to the fact that they have said themselves that they've received representations from two pathology providers, and it might be interesting if we just ask for a bit more detail on that as well as to what that, you know, because it doesn't really tell us any more other than that they've received a submission. So I think it would be useful to have that and to pull together, as Fergus Ewing suggested. Are there any other suggestions over and above that that colleagues want to make?
But the reference to Japan and perhaps other countries, I mean, if that needs to be followed up, maybe that's something the clerks could consider as well, because we wouldn't want to leave any stone unturned.
Okay. I think we've covered the ground mainly at this stage. Are we going to get that evidence first before... I'm just trying to think of the sequentially where we want to be.
Because it's 7 months is not a long time, and yeah, it may well be that the meat of the negotiation
is
being conducted right now. My point is we may miss the chance.
Yes, so I think we want the most comprehensive letter at this stage, right? I think that.
Yeah, flag it up to the minister now. Specifically,
yeah. Yes, I think it might be risky to be sequential here. Let's just get it all in there now. Are we content with that? Faisal Chowdhury.
Can we ask the Crown Office if they have any other alternatives or any? Have they done anything at all to find any solutions? If they've done anything at all since they met us last time? Because, of course, we were concerned and we did see the reaction of the Lord Advocate, which is not. You know, so to me, I don't know if they've done anything or not. Can we not ask them if they've done anything at all? Any other alternatives?
Yes, we can do that. I mean, I suppose the only thing they've said is they've had these two submissions, but that's not really action. It's just a reflection of the fact they've had two submissions. So, you know, thank you for that. Colleagues, are we content to proceed on that basis? That's great. Thank you very much. And so the petition remains open, and I think I'm hopeful that the Parliament will actually be able to influence the outcome and advance the aims of the petition as we proceed. So let's hope that we do. And to thank you, Monica, for your ongoing interest, and obviously the petitioner for all the interest she shows. I certainly appreciated just having an opportunity to read the response that the petitioner received themselves from the Lord Advocate, which was economical in the respect of the issue. But I do think that the opportunity to advance the aims exists. So thank you, everybody. Petition number 1955, colleagues, to make a provision of public toilets a statutory duty, which was lodged by John Wood, and calls on the Parliament to urge the Scottish Government to ensure local authorities provide good quality, clean and accessible toilets by placing a statutory duty on local authorities to provide adequate such toilets and ensuring sufficient funding is available to meet this requirement for local authorities. Now, since our last consideration of this petition, we've received information from Highland Council and Aberdeenshire Council about their use of the Comfort Scheme. Members will recall that this is a voluntary scheme whereby businesses and organisations can obtain grants when they register to become providers of toilet facilities. The written submissions provide information about how many businesses and organisations are registered, the cost of the scheme to local authorities, and their approaches to advertising the existence of the scheme. Now, Scottish Government has provided information about the Rural Tourism Infrastructure Fund as it relates to public toilets. And while this information has been useful for the committee in understanding the current landscape and alternative routes for providing facilities, the petitioner has stressed the importance of the petition's main ask. The petitioner does not feel that the Comfort Scheme is a satisfactory alternative, and that the Real Tourism Infrastructure Fund is not an appropriate source of funding for basic public service. He has reiterated that public toilets are a basic requirement of public health and hygiene, stating that only a statutory duty and sufficient revenue will provide this requirement. And I wonder if colleagues have got any comments or suggestions to make. Mr. Torrance.
Thank you, Convener. I have sympathy with the petition, but the Scottish Government has stated that we will not impose a statutory duty on the 32 local authorities, because it's for up to them to decide whether they fund public toilets or not. And as somebody who in Fife has seen a Comfort Scheme work really, really well, especially
to see somebody uses public toilets
along the coastal path, I think there is nowhere for us to go, because the Scottish Government has been very clear that it will not impose a statutory duty on councils. So I'm asking the committee if it would consider closing the petition under Rule 15.7 of Standard Orders on the basis that the Scottish Government has no plans at this time to make provision of public toilets a statutory obligation on local authorities.
Mr. Ewing.
Yes, I would back up what Mr. Torrance said, and I would just like to add that I think I perhaps owe the petitioner an apology, because I did, in my remarks the last time we considered this, specifically suggest that we look at the Rural Tourism Infrastructure Fund. And the reason I did that, Convener, is I knew from experience that I had as a minister that this was a practical way of providing funding for something, and that's why I suggested it. But seeing the petitioner's response, he made the very fair point that that really was a red herring or a cul-de-sac, or whatever you want to say. He was concerned about the basic human right of having a public convenience, and I just wish to put on the record that I didn't mean in any way disrespect the petitioner, but I do think that for the reasons Mr. Torrance has described, it's plain that whilst we admire and respect the point he's principle he's pursuing. It's not something that we can take any further. But I did want to make that clear to the petitioner, because I fear he didn't understand what I was trying to do, which is to be helpful in a pragmatic way.
Thank you, Mr. Ewing. I think that was clear as the objective. But of course, this petition, the Petitions Committee, is not making an editorial judgment on the merits of the petition at all. At the end of the day, we seek to advance the aims of the petition as best we can, but the decision ultimately as to whether or not the aims of the petition are fulfilled is one for the government, and the government has come back and said it doesn't intend to pursue the statutory route, and for that reason we have Mr. Torrance's recommendation that we close this petition. Are members content to do it? Faisal Chowdhury.
Yeah, I think it's an ongoing issue. I've been getting quite a lot of emails from constituents from Lothian and Edinburgh, where, I mean, I had business in Dalry. I was involved in Dalry a long time ago, and toilets and everything are closing in Dalry area. It's putting extra pressure on the local businesses. So if people are coming in with pregnant women or any people with diabetics, etc., there is no public toilet in that area at all. It's putting extra pressure on the local businesses. And sometimes the staff working are under pressure. If someone wants to use the toilet, they're not allowing it. It can cause into trouble. So I'm not really sure. I think it's an ongoing issue. We do need to consider this. And I think it's a health issue as well, mental health issue too. So I don't know how long this petition has been going on, being new in this committee. But I do feel that that's an ongoing issue, and we do need to consider and support the local businesses. Because Edinburgh, if you go, all the public toilets are more or less closing now. So where does people go?
So if I can coalesce your view, you would prefer to see us keep the petition open, go back to the Scottish Government, highlighting the petitioner's latest evidence, perhaps also, in your words, if I can paraphrase them, saying that there appear to be further public service toilet closures taking place, and that this is placing a kind of burden of expectation on local businesses, which is unreasonable, and that for those reasons the government should have a further think as to whether or not it would be prepared to consider its position. Is that
correct? Yes, that's correct. Yes.
So we've got the two. What, Mr. Torrance, are you content, or what's your view?
No, I'm quite happy to push it. We close it under Rule 15.7 of Standing Orders, because the Scottish Government is not going to change its mind about imposing anything on local authorities, because they're autonomous to make up their own decisions.
Would you be content, Mr. Chowdhury, if we closed the petition but sent a further letter to the to the Government in doing so, highlighting the issues as you've described them, and saying that we have noted what the government has said, we recognise it's unlikely it's going to change, but this is a matter of concern, and we think it's worth them being aware of the continuing difficulties that are arising. Would that help?
Yeah, that would, but I think we do need to support the local businesses as well, and the staff working as well, because, as I said, it is a big mental health issue, and I do know, because I was involved in catering industry and entertainment. So I think, happy to...
I think Mr. Torrance's conclusion, supported by Mr. Ewing, that it doesn't look like the government is going to change its view on the statutory matter.
We can always ask.
And have been now twice they've come back to tell us that. So, I mean, but I think we could draw to their attention why it's a matter of ongoing concern. And okay. Mr. Golden.
I think that's a sensible course of action, Convener. I think it would be useful to get the Scottish Government view as part of that letter on the point that toilet provision is a basic requirement of public health and hygiene, and what their thoughts are on that.
Well, then we're not closing the petition. we've not quite got... Mr. Ewing, do you have any further reflection here? Because we've now got... two colleagues suggesting we close, and two colleagues who prefer to have a further go drawing these latest matters to the attention of the government.
I absolutely understand the points that my colleagues who've proposed a different method make. At the end of the day, I think the the argument Mr. Torrance put that the Scottish Government is not going to change its position is, seems to me to be pretty much correct and not really open to doubt. So I do think that the views that my colleagues have expressed are perfectly legitimate views, but they perhaps need to be pursued in the political arena, because I feel as a committee I'm not sure that we will really get any further with that. I do absolutely agree we could write to the minister setting out the reservations that perhaps we all have about this as an approach, but I don't think the approach is going to change. I'm certain the approach is not going to change, and therefore, you know, I do think we should probably close the petition, subject to your helpful suggestion of writing to the minister. And I do share the concerns. I think we all do, and it's a particular problem in the Highlands because of the distances involved and between, you know, available opportunities, shall we say.
Rather unusually, over the issue of public conveniences, I'm invited to come to a casting position. And I think I am minded to close the petition, but to accompany that closure with a directional letter to the government on the concerns we have about the approach they've decided to adopt, but recognising that it does appear that they are not prepared to reconsider it. And I think that will be for others to pursue in a different environment. Thank you all very much. Petition number 1973. I'm going to jump because we have Rhoda Grant with us. Now, I'm quite happy to try and facilitate Rhoda's morning by bringing the petitions with which I know she has an interest this morning forward to this point. And they are petition number 1974 to adopt the A90 as a trunk road, and petition 1980 to adopt the A832 between Achnashan and Gorston as a trunk road. Nasheen, I should think. We now come to these have both been lodged by Derek Noble, and the 1974 calls on the Scottish Parliament to urge the Scottish Government to adopt the A90 as a trunk road and to resolve the safety problems associated with the Strumferry bypass, while petition number 1980 calls on the Scottish Parliament to urge the Scottish Government to adopt the A832 between Achnashan and Gorston as a trunk road connecting this route into the existing trunk road network. We considered these petitions on the 18th of January, where we agreed to write to a range of stakeholders to seek further information on the issues raised. And as I said a moment ago, we're joined this morning by our colleague Rhoda Grant. Good morning and welcome to you, Rhoda. I'm pleased to say that we have received responses from Lough Carron Community Council and the Plockton and District Community Council, which highlight the disruption residents and others face when rock falls cause a closure of the A90, as well as their support for action to recognise the increased volume of traffic on this route and improve the quality of road surface. We also received a response in February from the then Minister for Transport, which suggests that although there is linkage between criteria set out in the Strategic Transport Projects Review and the A890, it is the government's assessment that the A890 does not sufficiently meet the criteria to be incorporated into the motorway and trunk road network. The minister also suggests that transferring the route to the trunk road network would not solve the investment challenges associated with addressing road safety and maintenance issues on this stretch of road. On a related point, the Visit Scotland response states that it considers road infrastructure an important part of the visitor experience, but that it would be for the Scottish Government to consider whether or not adopting the A832 as a trunk road would improve outcomes for both residents and visitors to the area. The response from Highland Council notes that it has done no further work on the Strumferry options appraisal since December 2019, given that the project has no capital programme support and no preferred option has been identified. And their response also states that while parts of the A832 may not meet today's design standards, the issues of the A890 Strumferry section outweigh these significantly. So, quite a range of responses, not altogether encouraging from the point of view of the petition, unfortunately. But before we ask the committee to reflect on what we've heard, can I invite Rhoda Grant just to comment anything she feels would be appropriate. Rhoda.
Thank you, and thank you for the chance to speak to the petitions, because I don't think I can really stress how vital these links are to the West Highlands. and they do link Scotland and the Highland Council area to the Western Isles, because it is seen as a link through to Uig and Skye, and from Uig into to Uist. So they are incredibly important. Now, you quoted the then Transport Minister talking about the Strategic Transport Projects Review and how it didn't meet the criteria wholly. Well, I don't understand that, because not only is it for local communities to access healthcare and education, for tourism, farming, aquaculture and renewables, it's also a freight link to the Western Isles. It's on the NC500, which we all know has been incredibly successful in encouraging tourists into the area, but that has put huge pressure on that road. So I believe it's of national significance because of that. You quoted the submissions from Loch Arran and Plockton Community Councils, and I think they highlight just how important this route is to the area, because if it's closed, the detour basically goes from west coast to east coast and back. So that's what you have to do. So that's 140 miles of a detour. Now, if you're a child going to Plockton High School from Loch Arran, you have to double that for a daily commute, 280 miles to get to high school. That's totally unacceptable. And this happens often, and often for long periods of time. So I really don't understand the then minister's reluctance. We also have freight going that route. If you think of the carbon emitted just for that additional 280-mile journey, that is certainly not good for the planet. Highland Council have been clear. They are keen to do something about this, but they simply don't have the money. Last year, they spent over £700,000, just trying to deal with the rock falls. And this year, they're looking at spending £1.5 million as well. And they have not been able to make any progress on the options appraisal they carried out. So I believe that those roads actually fulfil the national strategic link that the government should be considering for them to become trunk roads. So I wonder if the committee, given we're two transport ministers since the last one responded to that, if we could go back to the current transport minister and ask her to consider the petition, because I think it is of national significance, and it's also of significance to the duties of the Scottish Government to make sure that children are educated. Now, I would have to say this was an issue when I went to school. This has been going on for some time, where children can't get to school because of rock falls. And at some point, there's going to be a horrendous accident, because it is dangerous. I mean, you take your life in your hands going across that road, and it's simply not good enough. So, you know, the local people really don't care who's responsible. But what is very, very clear is Highland Council doesn't have the money to do that. We've seen cuts in local government finance. People need safe roads. So if the Scottish Government isn't willing to adopt, they should be looking to make capital available to make this road safe, or to reroute it into a safer road. So I know the committee will be tempted to close this petition because they've had a response from the Scottish Government, but I would ask them if they would prevail on the Scottish Government again, just given the national significance of this route and its importance to education, that they would change their mind and at least look at how they can assist.
Thank you very much, Rhoda Grant. Fergus Ewing, you obviously engaged in the discussion we had when we last considered this petition, and I can see you're keen to come in just now.
Thank you, Andy. I would endorse what Rhoda Grant has said, and if she doesn't mind my saying so, if this has been a problem since she was at school, then it's not something that's just arisen yesterday, if I can put it no more candidly than that. But to be serious, I mean, this is a Highland problem, and it's been highlighted very well, and the community councils have replied. Plockton is pointing out that when the road is closed, there's a 130-mile diversion. I mean, who would put up with that in the Central Belt? And they refer to the closures because of rock landslides that Rhoda has mentioned, Grant has referred to today, and the road surface is an embarrassment, potholes that look like World War I shell craters. I do like unvarnished prose, uncluttered by euphemism and government jargon. I do like that. But seriously, I think the serious point is that Transport Scotland have said that it doesn't meet the criteria, but they haven't said why. They've listed the criteria. Some of the criteria appear absolutely to apply, and Rhoda has covered that. I mean, this does link remote communities, and this does link key tourist areas. I mean, those two criteria are clearly met. So Transport Scotland say, deploying said government style of prose, although there is a linkage with some of these criteria, it's our assessment that it doesn't sufficiently meet the criteria to be incorporated into the strategic motorway and trunk road. Well, they don't say why. And I think our job is to tease out, you know, why and why not. And the last point I make is that, which I made in the previous session, convener, that, you know, the Highland Council covers an area larger than Belgium and 20% larger than Wales, and with far, far more of a road network than any other local authority, even the Borders, which is a substantial one. And therefore, the burden of maintenance of these local roads is absolutely massive. And therefore, if it is subsumed as a national trunk road, which I believe it should be, then at least it slightly diminishes the impossible burden that the Highland Council Roads Department have got in dealing with these pothole situations which appear all over. So I would strongly endorse what's been argued today by Rhoda, and I think we do need to pursue this more. It may be that it's difficult, but at the end of the day, convener, Transport Scotland has got to show that it understands, is sympathetic to the interests of the Highlands, and at the moment, the very strong feeling in the Highlands is that that doesn't exist at the current time with a Glasgow-based quango.
Mr. Ewing, I'm going to assume there was no connection between your observations about Miss Grant being at school and World War I potholes. That was just an unintended... Yes, I would have thought it would have been very much so. And I wonder who's left to actually evidence that it looks like a World War I pothole, but maybe there is somebody in the Highlands where, of course, they're all long-lived. But... essentially, I think, Mr. Ewing, your view is that, and you're right, I mean, we've simply been told that the government does not consider that it does, but doesn't really, in the light of the actual evidence that's been attested, explain why they've come to that view and justify it. They've simply asserted it, and that we should ask them to do so.
Yep. Well, I'd be happy with that if other members... feel that that's appropriate.
Would other colleagues be prepared for us to proceed on that basis?
Agreed.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much, Rhoda Grant. I think you did contribute to a different outcome being achieved in our consideration of the petition this morning. So thank you for that. That brings us to petition number 1973. Which is to end the use of sheriff's discretion when ruling in civil cases and provide clear legal guidance on division of assets. And this has been lodged by Sandy Isett. The petition calls on the Scottish Parliament to urge the Scottish Government to review the Family Law Scotland Act of 2006 and to provide greater clarity on the division of assets in cases of cohabiting couples who are separating by removing the use of sheriff's discretion rulings in civil cases, providing clear legal guidance to the Law Society of Scotland on the division of assets for cohabiting couples, allowing appeals to be heard where it is determined that a sheriff has the rule of law wrong but have used their discretion to prevent an appeal at no cost to the appellant, and publishing information on what resources have been allocated to provide clear legal guidance. Last considered on 21st of December, when we agreed to write to a number of organisations, including the Scottish Government, the Scottish Law Commission, the Law Society of Scotland, the Family Law Association, and we've received submissions from the Scottish Law Commission and the then Minister for Community Safety and the Law Society of Scotland. Scottish Law Commission confirmed that judicial discretion was considered as part of their work on reform of the law relating to cohabitation, with their final report and recommended reforms having been published in November 22. In her response, the Minister was unable to commit to a timescale for bringing forward legislation in relation to the Commission's recommendations, but said that the Government was considering how to implement a number of Commission reports, including the one on cohabitation, during this parliamentary session. And the Law Society response indicates that it would not support the removal of discretion in civil cases, noting that every court decision involves an element of discretion or judgment on part of the sheriff. The response goes on to state that the Society is broadly supportive of the reforms proposed by the Scottish Law Commission. Broadly supportive. Colleagues, does anyone have any comment or suggestion to make? Mr. Torrance.
Thank you.
Well, are you thinking of contributing to this one, Mr. Ewing? Or? Maybe come to you first then, Mr. Ewing.
As it happens, by sheer coincidence, I've spent many hundreds of hours on dealing with the Family Law of Scotland Act 85, which I think most practitioners feel is a very, very good piece of legislation, which clearly set out clear rules for the division of matrimonial property on divorce, and doesn't have the problems associated with the Family of Scotland 206, which deals with cohabitants as opposed to married couples. And there's, not all cohabitants may necessarily want to make a lifelong commitment, so they cannot be equiparated. But at the time of the passage of the 206 Act, I think I did opine that that Parliament perhaps felt that cohabitants were getting the same rights as married couples. They weren't. And of course, the format of the Act was to provide very clear discretion to sheriffs to determine what financial settlement was suitable. And the sheriffs, Sheriff Pyle, for example, and others, and in Court of Session judges, have said that the discretion is very, very wide. And that makes it difficult for lawyers to advise because it's not clear really what the fair outcome should be. So all of that means that it would be desirable, I think, to have law reform. That, after all, is the purpose of this place. And the suggestion I was going to make was this, that that in the recommendation suggested to us that we might think of closing, it's because the Scottish Government anticipates bringing forward legislation in the current parliamentary session. Now, I checked yesterday in the programme for government, it's not one of the acts that is in the 23-24 legislative programme. And that then means that we would probably be at the coup's tail if it's going to be at it, and perhaps not even at the coup's tail. So my suggestion is very simple, cutting through all the complexities here of the issues, the substantive issues, and just ask that we write to the Scottish Government before we close it, saying, we understand that this is to be a bill in this session of Parliament. Is that still the case or not? And if not, can we get a view from the Law Commission and others, including the Scottish Government officials, as to when the bill is likely to be ready, because this will be a bill that will, I think, be substantially dependent upon the Commission and the Law Society and practitioners coming with a thesis. I don't think it's something that, MSPs can be expected to bring forward. It's highly technical, highly complicated. A lot of work has been done, but it looks to me as if this bill won't be before us in this session of Parliament. And therefore, out of respect for the petitioner, I think we should, find out what the facts are, given the absence of this bill in the programme which was announced yesterday for this coming year.
Thank you, Mr. Ewing. Are colleagues content to proceed on that basis?
Yes, they are.
Yeah, thank you. Well, we will seek to get that information. Thank you very much. That brings us to consideration of item 4 on the agenda, which is new petitions, and since this is the start of the session, as I do ahead of each petition when we consider it, just to say that those people who might be looking in our proceedings, who have lodged a petition or simply following how a petition might be progressing, that ahead of our consideration of the petition for the first time as a committee, we do seek the views of the Scottish Government and also of SPICE, our independent research operation within the Scottish Parliament, to assist us, and therefore we aren't considering the petition for the first time without any views having already been received. The first petition that we've received under this item is petition number 2023, as it happens, which is to stop the deposit return scheme lodged by Jim Foster. The petition calls on the Scottish Parliament to urge the Scottish Government to stop the introduction of the 20p deposit off for consumers and the rollout of the deposit return scheme. It is the petitioners' view that introducing the scheme will increase costs to the consumer, punishing those who already recycle and result in additional journeys to recycling centres. The Minister's response to the petition, received in May, reaffirmed the Scottish Government's commitment to launching the scheme in March 24. However, as can happen with the consideration of petitions from time to time, events have overtaken us. Members will be aware that the Minister announced before the summer recess that the introduction of the deposit return scheme would be delayed until October 2025 at the earliest. Although I don't think we've heard from the Minister directly as a committee, that's simply our reading of the matters in Parliament. Do members have any comments or suggestions for action in relation to this petition? I hesitate, Mr. Torrance, but Mr. Torrance.
Thank you, Convener. Considering the government's position and the scheme has been delayed to October 2025, I'd like to close a petition under Rule 15.7 on the basis that the Scottish Government has paused the introduction of a deposit return scheme until October 2025.
And of course the petitioner would have the opportunity to lodge a fresh petition for consideration by the committee at that time, depending on the government's decision thereat.
Yes.
Mr. Ewing?
It's ironic that, in one respect at least, we've achieved what the petitioner wanted before the petition was even considered. So that must be something that is perhaps not a triumph, but certainly unusual. But of course, it's just a referral. But I think I would agree with Mr. Torrance for this reason, that my understanding is that the lead committee it really is still considering this issue as live and is unlikely to cease so doing. You know, it's got the bit between its teeth. It's been considering this in detail. I think it would actually be wrong for us to start to take on any serious consideration of a matter where a lead committee has devoted, you know, a huge amount of time and effort to it. I don't know whether it's still live, but certainly there is still public debate about it. Most recently, the UK government suggested it would be 226, not 225, and that's been resisted by the minister, I believe. But I think all these matters, convener, will almost certainly be raised by members in the lead committee. And therefore, I think it would be otios for us to come along and stick our neb in. And therefore, the petitioner is quite entitled to go to the lead committee and make representations to his or her MSP to that effect. And they would be the more appropriate vehicle within which to raise these issues. I don't know. I mean, I did kind of work with Mr. Golden and other members on this matter, and I'd be interested to hear what he thinks. But that's my honest view, despite the fact that I would very much like to question the minister, but perhaps another time, another day.
Mr. Golden?
Yeah, I would agree that we should close it, at least partly on the basis that we don't know for sure what we're stopping, the scope and form of that. There's quite a changing landscape in terms of extended producer responsibility, a delay to our UK scheme to 2026, which may or may not have implications for us in Scotland. There's also a potential for a different form of deposit return scheme via the Circular Economy Bill, which we wait to see subsequent amendments regarding that. And therefore, it's not clear to me exactly what we're stopping, and it may be that a new form of deposit return scheme, the petitioner may look kindly on that if it was a digital one, something around refillables. So until we know what we're stopping and the petitioner knows what we're stopping, then I think we have no option other than to close it.
Thank you. I think that seems fairly consensual amongst colleagues. So are we content to support Mr. Torrance's proposal? We are, and we will write the petition, I think, just offering the opportunity, but I think also just reflecting on some of the points Mr. Golden made as well about the committee not absolutely being certain what it would be that we would be stopping at this stage. That brings us to the second of our new petitions, petition number 2024, to create a national public information programme to raise awareness of the impacts of steroids, selective androgen receptor modulators and other performance-enhancing drugs. This has been lodged by Cale Scott. This, and it calls on the Parliament to urge the Scottish Government to create a national public information programme to raise awareness of the impacts of using steroids, selective androgen receptor modulators, SARMs, and other performance-enhancing drugs. I'm not sure whether it's a PEDs or PEDs, which should include a particular focus on the impact on young people aged 16 to 25, working with community learning and development practitioners, gyms and community coaches to raise awareness, and developing a public health campaign to highlight the negative impacts of PEDs, encourage irregular health checkups for users, and a screening programme allowing users to test the safety of their PEDs. Cale tells us one of his friends was admitted to hospital with a life-threatening issue resulting from steroid use, and having seen many people at his gym use performance-enhancing drugs without any apparent impact, Cale's friend had been unaware of the severity of the impact they can cause. Cale notes that this was not an isolated incident, and raises concerns about how easily and widely promoted these drugs are, with information about negative impacts not being provided. The Spice briefing sets out the distinction between anabolic steroids, which are Class C drugs that can be prescribed by pharmacists for personal use, and selective androgen receptor modulators, which can be legally purchased in the UK without age restrictions. It is the latter that are gaining popularity, partly due to a heavy promotion on social media. The Scottish Government response outlines the work being done by the Scottish Drugs Forum to provide information and training. And their response also states its commitment to developing public health surveillance data to better understand drug trends, saying that the work could be further enhanced to include the substances highlighted by this petition. It refers to a multi-agency working group whose work includes the development of a set of standards to support young people with their drug use. We've also received a further submission from the petitioner, which welcomes some of the activities set out by the government, but also raises concerns that the current approach does not address the main harms that are associated with performance-enhancing drugs, namely hepatic and kidney disorders and cardiovascular disorders. So, quite an important issue that's been drawn to the committee's attention by the petitioner, and I wonder what thoughts colleagues might have on how we would approach this. Mr. Torrens?
Thank you, Convener. I wonder if the committee would like to continue this petition and write to the UK Anti-Doping, Anabolic Steroids UK, and the Scottish Drugs Forum, seeking their views on the action called in the petition. I'd also like the committee to write to the Scottish Government to highlight the petitioner's submission and seek clarity on the membership and terms of reference of a multi-agency working group.
Thank you. Any other suggestions? Mr. Ewing.
I would endorse that. And just looking at the petitioner's response to the Scottish Government main response, I was struck by the very detailed response that the petitioner has given to that. And the fact that, as well as saying that the Scottish Government don't seem to be covering the issues that he believes are relevant, he also says that the multi-agency group that is referred to by the Scottish Government may not include the right people, and he goes through who these may be. Now, this is not an area I know much about, but what he's basically saying is that there's young people between 16 and 25 that go to gyms that have access to these steroids with really no guidance or information about how to use them, what the risks are. And therefore, I think he's saying that people in that world, perhaps with experience of being in charge of running the gyms and having a kind of a medical background or whatever, should be involved in the multi-agency group. And I wonder if when we do write to the Scottish Government, we could specifically ask about those range of suggestions that the petitioner has made so that we can get answers on them now, because I suspect if we didn't, we would probably just come back and get the same points from the petitioner again, who may feel that we haven't pursued the quite substantive and concrete points that he made in his response.
With that, are colleagues content with that? Clerks, that'd be fine. That's great. Thank you very much. So the petition will remain open, and we will write to the various organisations as suggested. Petition number 2025, to improve the support available to victims of domestic violence who've been forced to flee their home. lodged by Bernadette Foley, calling on the Parliament to urge the Scottish Government to improve the support available to victims of domestic violence who've been forced to flee their marital home by ensuring access to legal aid for divorce proceedings where domestic violence is a contributing factor, ensuring victims are financially compensated for the loss of the marital home, including loss of personal possessions and furniture left in the property, and ensuring that victims are consulted before any changes are made to non-harassment orders. Now, in the background to this petition, Bernadette explains that her sister faced threats and harassment from her ex-husband, whose family emptied their marital home of all furniture, fixtures and fittings, with the police seemingly unable to take any action to prevent this. Bernadette also tells us of the mental and physical impact this experience has had on her sister and how she had been unable to assess financial support to help replace her possessions and start over. Now, the Spice briefing notes that the Domestic Abuse Protection Scotland Act 2021 introduces two short-term civil protection orders, both of which could exclude a perpetrator of domestic abuse from where the person at risk lives. However, this part of the Act is not yet in force. In responding to the petition, the Minister of Victims and Community Safety notes that civil legal aid is available to a wide range of actions, including contested divorce, and that around 70% of the population are eligible for some form of legal aid. The Minister also highlights other options, such as the Scottish Women's Rights Centre, which offers free legal information and advice to those who have experienced gender-based violence. The Minister also refers to the work undertaken on improving housing outcomes for women and children experiencing domestic abuse, including options for financial support for women leaving an abusive partner. As the committee is aware, our consideration of related petitions, the Minister also refers to Scottish Law Commission's plans to review civil remedies available for domestic abuse as part of its work on family law. In the light of all that, do colleagues have any suggestions as to how we might proceed? Mr. Torrance.
Thank you, Convener. Hopefully the committee will keep this petition open and dig a wee bit more into it. And in doing so, and if they're going to, under my recommendations, I hopefully would write to Scottish Women's Aid, the Scottish Women's Rights Centre and the Law Society of Scotland, seeking their views on the action called for in the petition. I'd also like the committee to write to the Scottish Law Commission to seek an update on the review of civil remedies for domestic abuse, including clarification on whether the issues raised by a petitioner will be included in the scope of a review. And I would also like the committee to write to the Scottish Government seeking clarification on when Part 1 of the Domestic Abuse Protection Scotland Act 2021 will be fully implemented.
Thank you. Do we have any other suggestions? And are we therefore content? We are. So this petition will remain open and we will again endeavour to understand the thinking of the various organisations to whom we will now write in the first instance. Petition number 2026 to eliminate council tax discounts for second homes and vacant properties lodged by Sam McCahon. The petition calls on the Scottish Parliament to urge the Scottish Government to amend the Local Government Finance Act of 1992 to eliminate council tax discounts for second homes and vacant properties to make the property owner rather than a tenant liable for payment of council tax. The Scottish Government's response provided may encourage the petitioner to contribute to a public consultation on the council tax treatment of second homes and empty properties, and this closed in July. The submission states that a joint working group on sources of local government funding and council tax reform has been convened and is considering targeted changes to council tax. The petitioner makes the case for the property owner rather than the occupier to be liable for council tax, saying this would promote justice and equity and reduce the cost of living for all residents in Scotland. The petitioner's view is that the council tax reduction scheme leads to significant revenue loss for councils and increases the burden on tenants and homeowners who do not qualify for the means-based tax reduction. The petitioner believes that the existing approach is effectively subsidising property owners' investments. Do members have any comments or suggestions? David Torrance.
I wonder if a committee would be inclined to write to the Scottish Government seeking a summary response of a recent consultation on council tax for second and empty homes and details of a future relevant work planned by a joint working group on sources of local government funding and council tax reform and its views on making the property owner liable for payment for council tax in light of the points raised in the petitioner's recent submission. I wonder if a committee could also write to Citizens Advice Scotland and Shelter Scotland seeking their views on the action called for in the petition.
Colleagues, are we content to support that suggestion? We are. Brings us to the final of our new petitions for consideration this morning, and that is petition number 2027. Launch the Changing Places Toilet Fund, launched by Sarah Heward on behalf of the Tindrum Infrastructure Group, calling on the Scottish Parliament to urge the Scottish Government to launch the £10 million Changing Places Toilet Fund that was pledged in the 2021 SNP manifesto without further delay, and make the application process clear, straightforward and expeditious for groups trying to build these much needed facilities. The response for the Minister for Social Care, Mental Wellbeing and Sport states that due to budget constraints, funding for the construction of Changing Places toilets has not yet been allocated and specific timelines for distribution remain unannounced. The submission emphasises the need to prioritise spending efficiently to benefit those in greatest need and states that further details of this investment will be provided over the parliamentary term. The petitioner's submission details the group's work to obtain the necessary permissions for a Changing Places toilet and notes that the only thing preventing them from building the facility is a lack of capital funding. She highlights the hardships faced by disabled individuals and their carers due to the absence of Changing Places toilets, including indignity, isolation and health risks. The positive impact seen in England, where similar funding has expanded access for disabled individuals, is cited. She notes the benefits seen in the local economy by tapping into the purple pound of potential tourists and customers in the disabled community. Do members have any comments or suggestions? Oh, I forgot, sorry, to just remind myself that we are joined, even though I directed him to the appropriate seat, by our colleague Paul O'Kane, MSP, this morning, who has an interest in this petition. And before we move to the consideration by the committee of potential options, I wonder if Paul would like to comment in support of the petition.
I'm very grateful, convener, and grateful to committee members for hearing me this morning. I am convener of the Parliament's cross-party group on Changing Places Toilets, a newly established cross-party group in this session. So have had opportunity to hear from a number of interested stakeholders in the provision of Changing Places Toilets across the country. I am sure that colleagues are aware of the benefit, the great benefit of these facilities in their own communities across Scotland. Not only, I think, because it's fundamentally the right thing to do, but actually because it benefits the whole of the community where a facility is put in place, particularly because many families feel that they can't be spontaneous and they can't enjoy the same access to tourism and leisure activities that other people do if these facilities aren't in place. So there is a benefit, I think, to the wider economy in terms of the provision of Changing Places toilets. Indeed, the convener may be aware in his own constituency of Rook and Glen Park's Changing Places facility, which was only recently opened and actually has added to the number of visitors that are coming from families, particularly who have disabled children. So it shows you the impact, I think, there. I think the challenge, speaking to the petition before us, is that there was a pledge made. It was obviously a party political pledge in terms of the manifesto, but it did feature in the 21-22 programme for government that a £10 million fund would be rolled out. Evidently, that has not yet happened. I appreciate what the Minister has said in terms of the financial constraints and challenges. However, I believe there is still a commitment to roll out funding by the end of the Parliament. I think what people really want to see is detail from government about its intentions for this fund, how, for example, applications might be made to the fund and what structure that might take. I think that would certainly go a way to help people to feel confident that the fund will be in place. Again, you know, the petitioner is someone who runs you know, a business, but is very keen to make her contribution as a business owner and be kind of supplemented and supported by capital funding for the wider community. So I think there are many people, whether they be third sector organisations or businesses, who are interested in actually putting in some of their own capital and their own funds in order to make a Changing Places toilet reality, but require that additional funding from government. So You know, I think there is a huge opportunity here. I think people are concerned that as we meet the midway point of the Parliament, that there doesn't seem to be progress. And of course, there has been progress in other parts of the UK. £30 million fund in England and Wales has been, England has been distributed and is actually looking to its phase two now. So what we're seeing is perhaps Scotland falling behind in terms of where changing places toilets are available. And that again goes back to the economic point that people may then choose to holiday in other places where there is greater provision. So really just to represent the views of the members of the CPG and to ask the committee to give it serious consideration, at least in terms of progress of how this might be structured. Thank you, Convener.
Thank you, Mr. Kane. And I think you're quite right. The government lit the fuse of expectation without the bang of delivery in terms of the public expecting progress on this issue. I wonder if colleagues have got any suggestions. Mr. Torrance.
Thank you, Convener. I wonder if we could write to Minister for Social Care, Mental Wellbeing and Sport, highlighting the quality and welfare issues raised by petitioner in recent submissions and asking when the promised £10 million will be allocated to the fund and when it will be distributed. I'm just wondering as well if we could highlight to the petitioner the Rural Tourism Infrastructure Fund, because that is available to build new toilets or provide upgrades. So it might be that that route might be a place for him to go as well.
Thank you. Any other suggestions from colleagues? Mr. Ewing.
I would very much endorse that and support the comments that we've heard from Paul O'Kane. And can I just add just one point, which is that I've certainly had constituents, parents of a child with profound disabilities, that are feel they cannot actually travel south of Inverness because there are no facilities on the A9 that are suitable for their child. I just thought I'd mention that because the petitioner, I think, is relating to Tyndrum, which is over on the A82 in the west, but this affects substantially, I think, rural Scotland, a point the petitioner makes.
Thank you. So are we content to welcome the petition, to keep it open, and to begin our investigative inquiry with the suggestions that have been made? We are. Thank you all very much. And that concludes the public part of our meeting this morning. And we will resume again on Wednesday, the 20th of September. And we'll now move into private session for consideration of items 5 and 6. Thank you.